Thank you for being here bright and early on this Tuesday morning in Philadelphia. So my name's Curtis Parvin. Thank you, Andy, for the introduction. I'm a senior principal scientist and manager of advanced statistical research at Bio-Rad Laboratories. I've been there since 2009, and before that I was at Washington University in St. Louis for 29 years. The fourth edition of C24, I'm the chair of the Document Development Committee. These are the authors that helped me with this. I've discovered that this is my first, probably only time that I'll be chairing a CLSI Document Development Committee. And I discovered that probably the most important thing you can do as chair is put together a good committee. And I was lucky enough to be able to do that. These are the people that were involved. There are a number of names that I'm sure will be recognizable to you. And it was a really, really excellent group that did a lot of work and really, really took this on and did an amazing job with it. This is the recent milestones timeline for the document and its current status. So the proposed draft was submitted for voting in December of last year. Then the committee convened and went through the 140 plus comments that were made during the draft voting phase. We completed that work in April. It's now in the hands of CLSI as they're doing the final editing and formatting of the document for final draft voting, which is going to occur later this month, with the idea that it will be published in September. So it's still officially in a draft stage. The C24 document has been a very popular and successful document for CLSI, and one of my stated goals was to not ruin it. So we wanted to keep all that was good about it and add where new issues had arisen, modify where things needed to be updated because of new ways of operating the laboratory, but basically keep the core of the document in terms of its principles and definitions. And I think we've succeeded in doing that. We have expanded the document quite a bit. It's hard to compare because of differences in formatting and such, but it probably, by most measures, the document's doubled in size from its third edition to the fourth edition. The notable additions all reflect things that have occurred since the publication of the third edition in 2006. Since the third edition was published in 2006, CLSI has published the EP23 document on risk management principles, which has had a big impact on the way we think about quality control in the laboratory, putting much more of a focus on patient risk. So a lot of the efforts that we've done in the fourth edition of C24 is trying to align the C24 principles and definitions along the lines of the EP23 model of patient risk management. As a result of that, it's some additional performance measures, additional ways of thinking about how we assess the merits of our quality control strategy have had to be introduced in order to reflect that patient risk focus. We've expanded the guidance on setting target values and SDs for quality control materials. There's a much greater focus on QC frequency, QC scheduling as part of the QC strategy. It seems like for a number of years now, the main question being asked about quality control is not what QC rules should I be using, but how often should I be testing QC? So we needed to reflect that in this document. So there's quite a bit more more pages devoted to issues related to QC frequency and QC scheduling. And another area that definitely has a patient focus is an emphasis on recovering from an out of control condition once it's been detected. So that quality control is not just about defining a QC plan that can detect an out-of-control condition as soon as possible, but it also, if we're going to take a patient focus, requires that we think about how we're going to recover from that out of control condition once it's been detected. Recovering meaning identifying and correcting patient results that have been reported that may have been erroneous and causing hazardous situations for the patient. So this is a figure that comes from EP23. Risk, as it's defined in EP23, patient risk, really has two components. It's defined as the probability of occurrence of patient harm and the severity of that harm. So risk is what's the likelihood that harm will occur and what is the severity of that harm. And this is a figure in EP23 that gives us example sequence of events that is a way we can think about the probability of occurrence of harm to a patient, starting with some initiating cause of a test system failure and ultimately ending in patient harm. So the idea is that there's some initiating cause that has some likelihood of causing a testing process failure. That testing process failure, depending on its magnitude, will generate incorrect patient results. If those incorrect patient results are not identified before they're reported, then they get reported, and that creates a hazardous situation for the patient. There's some likelihood that that incorrect result will lead to a misdiagnosis or an incorrect action by the healthcare provider or the patient, and then that causes patient harm. So this is the sequence of events that we can think of that start with an initiating cause and end in patient harm. And the P1, P2, P3 are meant to denote probabilities. So it's the probability of going from one to the next stage that will be the way that we can think about what the probability of patient harm is from an initiating cause of an out-of-control condition. The other side of it is severity of harm, and this is a table in EP23. It's called a risk acceptability matrix. And what it's showing in the columns are different categories of severity of harm, starting on the left with negligible and moving to the right, catastrophic. And the rows are the probability of harm, the acceptable probability of harm. And the idea here is that the more severe the harm to a patient from an incorrect patient result being acted upon inappropriately, the less tolerance we should have for those kinds of out of control conditions occurring or those kinds of errors occurring. So the cells shaded in blue are considered unacceptable. The cells in blue are considered unacceptable. And as you can see, as we get to more and more severe harm, the frequency of harm that's considered acceptable becomes more and more stringent, okay? So this is the way we can think about then what kinds of strategies we have to have in place and how many incorrect results we're willing to tolerate from an out of control condition as a function of the severity of harm to the patient. So those two concepts, probability of harm and severity of patient harm, are concepts that we've tried to make an integral part of the way that we talk about principles and definitions of quality control in the laboratory. So we get back to this slide. Really, laboratory quality control has its impact in this area, okay? So we in laboratory quality control have to think about how what we do in QC impacts the probability of detecting a testing process failure. When an initiating cause of an out of control condition occurs, how good are we with our laboratory quality control at detecting that out of control condition? We also have to be concerned about when an out of control condition does occur, before we detect it, how many incorrect patient results are reported, produced and reported, okay? And the key here, in the sequence of events, it gives a P3, what's the probability of an incorrect result? But really, one of the key distinguishers in laboratory medicine is that one out of control condition, one testing process failure can lead potentially to many, many patient results that are affected adversely by that. Not just one, but many. So that's why I have number of incorrect patient results reported before an out of control detection. That is something that we have to think about in our laboratory quality control. What what do we feel are the number of patient results that might get reported before we detect the problem? And then lastly, from a risk management perspective, we have to think about those incorrect results that have been reported. How effective are we at, when we detect the out of control condition, at identifying incorrect results that have already been reported and updating them before they create harm for the patient? So this first step is traditionally what C24 has been about, identifying our ability to detect out of control conditions when they occur. How good are we at that? How do we design a QC strategy so that we have a high probability of detecting an out of control condition when it occurs? That's a focus that's really on taking care of the instrument, right? Making sure that our instrument is healthy, and when something goes wrong, that we identify it and we correct it. These next two steps are really have more of a patient focus. It's now, when an out of control condition does occur, what is the impact on the patient in terms of incorrect results being reported and acted upon inappropriately? So because we have more of a patient focus in the document, it requires us to talk about some performance measures that weren't in previous editions of the document, primarily around the idea of the number of erroneous patient results that are generated in the event of an out of control condition before it's detected. And what does that depend upon? Thinking about the principles and concepts around that. And the number of erroneous results, if you think about it, it's going to depend upon the magnitude of the out of control condition. We know that in the laboratory, there's not just in control, out of control, two states, but there's an infinite number of possibilities for out of control conditions that might occur. And each of those will have with it associated a different likelihood of producing results that fail the quality requirements. So it's going to depend on the magnitude of the out of control condition. It's going to depend upon the QC strategy. That is, how many QCs are we evaluating? What QC rules are we using? And importantly, how frequently are we testing quality controls? What's our QC schedule? And it's going to depend on our quality requirement. And of those erroneous results, we can think about a distinction between those that are reported, acted upon, and cause a hazardous situation for the patient, leading to patient harm, versus those that were reported but identified and corrected and preventing that hazardous situation. So we think about, in the terms that I've used, final patient results, unreliable final patient results, those are ones that were reported, never identified as being erroneous, lead to whatever medical decisions were made based on that result, versus correctable, or those that were reported, but in the process of our recovery were identified and corrected and prevented that hazardous situation. So the main chapters, the bulk of the C24 document are these chapters. Chapter 3, purpose of statistical quality control, 4, assessing quality control performance, and so on. I have attempted to kind of cover very briefly the ideas in C24, fourth edition, on the purpose of quality control and assessing performance with some of these new metrics related to patient risk. Chapter 5, planning a statistical quality control strategy, is going to be the subject of Dr. Miller's presentation. And chapters 6 and 7, recovering from an out of control condition and ongoing assessment, are going to be the subject of Dr. Bauman's presentation. So our speakers, our last speaker is Nikki Bauman. Dr. Bauman received her PhD from the University of Wisconsin in Madison, did a postdoc in clinical chemistry at Washington University. I think in 2003 she came, so I met her for the first time 13 years ago at Washington University when she was just a young pup right out of her PhD program, and have known her ever since. We've become good friends. She now is an assistant professor of lab medicine and pathology at the Mayo Clinic, where she's co-director of the Central Clinical Lab and director of Central Processing, and also the director of the Clinical Chemistry Fellowship Program. In the many years that I was at Washington University, I had the opportunity to interact with large number of postdocs that came through the program, and it's just warms my heart to see how so many of them now have gone out and are becoming leaders in their own right, and Nikki Bauman is one of them. Nikki's active in the AACC both at regional and national level, and she actually has become a fairly influential contributor to the topic of preparing and recovering from large-scale testing errors. I actually reached out to her and asked her if she would serve on the Document Development Committee because of the work that she's been doing in this area and because I felt it was one of the new important areas that we wanted to address in the fourth edition. So she agreed to do that, and she has been a very important contributor to those sections of the new document on recovery. Our next speaker is Dr. Greg Miller, someone I'm sure you all know and don't need me to tell you about. He received his PhD from the University of Arizona in Tucson, did his postdoc in clinical chemistry at The Ohio State University. He's currently a professor of pathology at Virginia Commonwealth University, and he's director of clinical chemistry and pathology information systems. That is a nice combination. I like that. He's past president of both the AACC and CLSI, so he has been very influential in both organizations. And he's been and continues to be a key contributor to committees and working groups for several organizations, all involved with standardization, harmonization, quality control, and external quality assessment. So with that, I'd like to ask Dr. Miller to come up and give his presentation on planning a statistical quality control strategy.